Hello and welcome to today's webinar, Trends and Opportunities in Accountability for Alternative Education, sponsored by the American Youth Policy Forum and Civic Enterprises. My name is Jenna Tomasello, Policy Associate at the American Youth Policy Forum. In case you are not familiar with AYPF, we are a nonprofit, nonpartisan convening organization based in Washington, D.C., focused on education, workforce development, and youth development issues. We bring together diverse stakeholders to discuss and frame issues to better inform policy with the ultimate goal of improving young people's lives, especially those traditionally underserved. To learn more about our events and resources, please visit our website at www.aypf.org. Before we get started, I want to provide a few logistical notes about today's webinar. In the event of any technical difficulties, you may dial 1-800-263-6317 to reach GoToWebinar's technical support line. Also, if you happen to lose connectivity, please just log back into the webinar. Live captioning of this webinar is accessible to all tuning in by a simple click of the link and will appear in a separate window from the webinar. Please check the chat box to the right of your screen for that link. Participants can adjust placement and size of the captioning window, along with the font, size, and color and speed of captioning. At any point during the webinar, you may type questions for our presenters into the questions box to the right of your screen, and we will do our best to answer as many as we can. This webinar will be recorded and posted on AYPF's website within 48 hours. When you exit the webinar, you'll receive a brief survey, and I encourage you to send us your feedback as it helps us to improve our programming. Today's webinar is part one of a three-part series on tools for promoting the education success of at-risk and systems-involved youth. In order to successfully transition to post-secondary education and workforce opportunities, young people need systems and supports to succeed in school and that prepare them for life's next steps. This three-part webinar series, co-sponsored by AYPF, Civic Enterprises, the Council of State Governments Justice Center, and the Legal Center for Youth Justice and Education, which is comprised of the Juvenile Law Center, Education Law Center, Southern Poverty Law Center, and the American Bar Association Center on Children and the Law, will highlight a number of recent tools for state leaders to help promote the education success of at-risk and systems-involved youth. This first webinar will focus on a new brief by Civic Enterprises and AYPF entitled Measuring Success, Accountability for Alternative Education. Highlight national trends from a recent 50-state scan and explore what alternative accountability looks like in the state of Wyoming. The second webinar, Improving Education Quality in Juvenile Justice Facilities, will take place on March 27th. And focus on a new brief by the Council of State Governments Justice Center and the American Youth Policy Forum entitled Leveraging the Every Student Succeeds Act to Improve Outcomes for Youth in the Juvenile Justice Facilities. Please check out the chat box to register for that webinar as well today. The third webinar, slated for April, will focus on the Legal Center for Youth Justice and Education's recent online toolkit, The Blueprint for Change, Education Success for Youth in the Juvenile Justice System. Please be on the lookout for more information about these additional webinars in this series. For those of you on social media, AYPF will be live tweeting today's event, and we encourage you to join the conversation on Twitter. Please follow us at AYPF_tweets, and we will be using the hashtag #ToolsForEdSuccess. That's tools, the number four, ed success. The Twitter handles for the organizations also featured on this webinar, Civic Enterprises and the Wyoming Department of Education, are also listed, and we encourage you to follow them as well. And without further ado, I would like to introduce today's presenters. First, we will hear from Dr. Jennifer DePauli, Senior Research and Policy Advisor at Civic Enterprises. Next, we will hear from Dr. Julie McGee, Director of Accountability at the Wyoming Department of Education. And finally, we will hear from our own Jesse Canham, Policy Research Assistant at the American Youth Policy Forum. Following each presenter, we will pause briefly to take audience questions, so be sure to send your questions via the questions box, and we will close out the webinar with an extended Q&A discussion. So please, Jen, start us off.
Thank you, Jenna. So as Jenna said, I am with Civic Enterprises, and every year we put out the Building a Grad Nation report, which reports to the nation on high school graduation rates, which was really our starting point in joining with AYPF to understand accountability for alternative education. And as Jenna said, we put out the measuring success brief. So this will just go over a little bit of what's in that brief, and hopefully all, if you're interested, you can go in and look at the brief to get a deeper dive of what we found states are looking at in terms of accountability for alternative education. So next slide. Thank you. So as I said, over the past few years, Grad Nation started looking at schools that will be identified for comprehensive support and improvement under the Every Student Succeeds Act. So if you don't know, schools will qualify if they have 100 or more students and they have a adjusted cohort graduation rate of 67% or less. And what we found is that alternative high schools are vastly overrepresented in low graduation rate high schools. And then what we also looked at was the fact that the rapid growth of this sector has led to both a mixed purpose of these schools and quality, and really inadequate systems to understand how these schools are doing and that how we should be holding them accountable. Next slide. So we started this brief from two key points. First, that all students should have a pathway to a secondary credential prepared for post-secondary education, careers, and life. So that was number one. And two, this question of what is the general purpose of accountability and its role in ensuring quality and continuous improvement of educational institutions, specifically here for alternative settings. Next slide. And so we started from this four-pillar look at what it means to have an accountability system, especially for alternative education. So our brief aims to address four key opportunities states have both within and outside of ESSA to better understand and ultimately improve alternative education. So I'll go through each of these four as we move forward. So the first one is defining alternative education. So there's currently no federal definition of alternative education. There is a one for the purposes of data collection by the National Center for Education Statistics, and they simply state that an alternative school is a public elementary or secondary school that addresses the needs of students that typically cannot be met in a regular school, provides non-traditional education, serves as an adjunct to a regular school, or falls outside the categories of regular special education or vocational education. So in some ways, the federal definition is defining it by not defining it. So go ahead to the next slide. So one thing that we think is really, really important is that states, when looking at how to hold alternative settings accountable, need to have a clear definition of what alternative education is going to be in their state. So these are some of the considerations that we think are really important for states right off the bat to take into consideration when setting their definition. So the student population that the schools will be intended to serve, the educational setting types. So are they going to be independent institutions? Will these be programs within schools? Will they be both? The length of time students typically spend within various alternative settings. So in some cases you have schools where these students are supposed to go full time and that's where they'll ultimately graduate from. Others will be places that students go for a semester or a quarter, depending on why they're there. The instructional environmental characteristics, so this would be, is it a type of online program? Is there some flexibility in the scheduling? So all those different types of instructional environmental characteristics. And then ultimately when you're looking at those things and setting the definition, the most important thing then is that it is codified properly. So once the codification happens, then it's a little bit easier to start holding schools accountable because you actually know what the schools are that you are holding accountable. Next slide, thank you. The second thing that we look at in the brief is the different types of accountability systems that states are looking at in order to hold these schools accountable. Go ahead to the next slide. So we break it down by looking at the three different types of systems that we have seen. So a single system with modifications, and a completely separate system. So we looked at this in terms of ESSA. So a single system would be a state that basically is saying that they're going to hold alternative settings and traditional settings the same regardless. So for identification and accountability purposes under ESSA, there will be no difference in how alternative schools are treated. Some states are going with what we would call the single system with modification. So one example of that would be an alternative school or program is considered the same as traditional schools in the state ESSA plan, but the state has included a differentiated measure for identification process or accountability. So one example would be Idaho. So Idaho is going to have one system of accountability, but when identifying the bottom 5% of schools, they're going to identify the bottom 5% of traditional schools and the bottom 5% of alternative schools separately. So that should help in some ways of making sure that there's not an overrepresentation of alternative schools. Some states have also chosen to create separate state systems to differentiate alternative settings. So this is outside of their ESSA plan. So a state like Wyoming, which you're going to hear about, so I won't go into too much, is something we would consider to be this type of single system of modification where within their ESSA plans, they'll be treated the same, but within the state, they're creating a different system to differentiate alternative settings. And then finally, separate systems. So alternative settings will be identified and held to different measures of accountability than traditional schools. So Colorado being an example of that, although their ESSA plan has not been approved, so we'll see what happens moving forward there. But so that would be a system where alternative schools are identified and held to different measures of accountability completely than traditional schools. And like I said, if you want more information on what some of these look like, you can see that in the brief. So we'll move on to the next part of the thank you for the next pillar. So the next pillar we looked at were measures. And this, I think, is probably the one that applies large scale to all states in terms of every state has to do these things, but how they do them can look very different. So regardless of the approach states in developing accountability systems, there's significant opportunity within ESSA's required indicators to be responsive to the unique conditions of alternative education. So states are required to set measures of academic achievement, graduation rate goals, progress in English language proficiency, and for the first time, include at least one measure of school quality and student success. These indicators, like I said, provide some level of flexibility. For example, states must measure proficiency in reading, language arts, and mathematics, but they may also choose to measure student growth in these subjects over time, which can be beneficial to alternative settings who often have students who are well behind grade level but are making significant progress to catch up. ESSA also requires states to report four-year graduation rates, but we see a lot of flexibility in the fact that ESSA is allowing states to finally report federally extended year graduation rates, which we think will be really helpful in terms of high schools that have students who come in behind and ultimately need time to make up. And then finally, the school quality and success indicator, or the non-academic indicator, must provide a way for states to meaningfully differentiate school performance. And we think it offers a lot of flexibility. And so as you can see, the two that we've seen the most in submitted ESSA plans are chronic absenteeism and school climate measures. So that's a place, though, we think can provide a lot of flexibility and give a bigger picture of what is going on in alternative settings. And finally, ESSA, like I said, the states are going to have to define or identify these lowest performing schools for continuous improvement and support. And you can go ahead to the next slide. And so we think this is a really interesting thing because we don't want to see schools, these alternative settings, be overrepresented. We don't think that that's one, fair to traditional schools, and two, it's not really giving us a true representation of what is going on in these schools. And so, you know, we know that without some level of flexibility and truly understanding how alternative schools and programs are faring, that they will be identified at really high rates. And you can see there that according to our 2016 analysis, when you look at the schools that would be identified, it was 12% of all high schools and 60% of alternative schools. So vast overrepresentation, and we'd like to see that avoided. And so we think that, you know, looking at some of these other things, like I just mentioned, might help with making sure that we have a more accurate representation of what alternative settings look like. And then lastly, we just want to point out that in terms of intervention, it's important to consider the differences in the needs of alternative schools and what's going on in those schools. In terms of selecting interventions, although we know little research has been done to this level of specificity. And we also want to point out, and we think this is really important, that when states are looking at systems of continuous improvement, that actual interventions that help in alternative settings may also benefit traditional schools. And we really think it's important that they not be overlooked when determining, you know, what's the evidence base and what is working in terms of making sure students are engaged and on track and getting what they really need out of school. So if you'd like more, I'm sure we're going to have some question and answer. And also, please check out the brief. We have a lot more in there than I was able to go over right now.
Hi, sorry about that, folks. Are you able to hear me all right? Great. I think I'm back on. Well, thank you so much, Jen. That was a fantastic presentation, and I just want to encourage all of the audience members to submit your questions into the questions box. We have a couple coming through, but we would like you to continue submitting those to us to answer now and then at a later point in the webinar as well. One question that we have that came in is around what can we learn about alternative schools when it comes to informing accountability for all academic settings? And so how can strategies related to accountability and alternative education inform accountability for all settings, Jen?
Yeah, I think that's a really good question, and one that I was trying to get at the end there a little bit, is that, you know, we know that really high quality alternative settings are doing a really good job of not only engaging students, but re-engaging students who were off track to begin with. And so there's a lot to learn there in terms of what, you know, what programs, what efforts need to be made, what kinds of connections need to be made to make sure that those students are on track. And honestly, because so many alternative programs now are more in that re-engagement space, you know, what can traditional schools learn from the students who are in those spaces? You know, what can they take away that can actually help, you know, keep them on track in the first place? So I think there's a lot that can be learned from alternative settings, and you know, for and also, you know, what isn't working. We know that there's a lot of these schools and programs that are popping up, you know, across certain states that aren't really re-engaging students or aren't really offering, you know, a high quality learning experience. So, you know, what can we do to make sure that those ones are ones that we try to get away from and really go after what are the high quality ones that a lot of states have great models of.
Great, fantastic. Another question we have that came in is, what is the best way for districts to identify best practices related to alternative education given limited research in this area? Can you speak to that, Jen?
Yeah, it's a very good question. You know, I think this is where what it comes down to is, because there's not such a great research base, is you know, finding the networks of that already exist that work. Like RAPSA is a great network of alternative education settings and leaders in that field that come together every year in usually October, November. And they, you know, try to do the best to really figure out what's going on in the space and speak to it. And there are a lot of other things that are coming up. You know, there's there's re-engagement forums that come up. So it's really about more right now trying to find these networks of that have come together in this field that, you know, can provide really interesting examples and models of what is going on. So that would be my best advice right now, and the lack of some really formal studies of what works in these settings.
Great. Well, thank you so much. That was a fantastic presentation. I think we are going to move on to just keep things moving here, but just a reminder to the audience, please continue to type your questions into the questions box. And for anyone who joined late, check your chat box, because we have been chatting out various resources that have been mentioned so far on the webinar, and also a recording of this webinar will be available on AYPF's website in 48 hours. All right, so moving on to you, Julie, take it away.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Julie McGee. I'm the Director of Accountability at the Wyoming Department of Education. And I just wanted to take a few minutes to talk to you about how we're handling alternative school accountability in our state. I wanted to start off by letting you know we have just 21 alternative schools in our state. We're a pretty small state. And an alternative school is defined as any school that is able to offer an educational program to students with educational needs that can't be met through a traditional high school. And this does exclude charter schools. Charter schools are treated separately and differently in our state. Next slide, please. So in 2015, our state legislature actually directed us to develop a framework for alternative school accountability. And we have presented to the legislature throughout the entire process ever since then. So we're going on 3 years of providing continual updates to the legislature about the work we've been doing. And the goal of this legislation was to create a model that would meaningfully differentiate alternative schools with other alternative schools, rather than comparing them to traditional high schools. Next slide. So the alternative school accountability framework in our state is comprised of four indicators, and they're listed here for you. The last two that you see there, climate and engagement, are a significant departure from our traditional model. These two items are not part of our traditional model. And so we'll get later on in the presentation, I'll explain how these all come together to produce a score. We put together what was called a technical advisory group. And this is a committee of alternative school principals and district superintendents that have alternative schools in their district, as well as department staff like myself and two technical experts from the Center for Assessment to help us create this model. Next slide. And this is a visual of the framework that was on the previous slide. Just a couple things I wanted to point out. You'll see student climate is on there twice, once to the left of the dashed line and once to the right. School climate to the left of the dashed line is the average of the survey scores that a school receives from its students. So we take each question and each category of questions and we average them together to produce a score. To the right of the line, that is a commendation that rewards participation. So if schools have a participation rate of at least 90%, then they can receive the highest rating. We have four ratings in our state, and the highest rating is exceeds expectations. Next slide. Oh, I think we need to go back one. I'm sorry. Okay, thank you. So under our model, the first indicator is academic performance, and that is a combination of achievement and growth. Achievement comes from the scores that the students receive on our state test. And so they will use the same state test as every other traditional high school in our state. But the cut scores that we use to determine the target score for achievement might be different. We won't know until after this school year. What we'll do is we'll take the performance of the schools, the alternative high schools, and we will develop cut scores that are appropriate for alternative high schools rather than using the same cut scores that we use for traditional high schools. And growth is based on the growth of students relative to their academic peers. So students who, say, performed at the 80th percentile last year, how much did they grow this year when you compare them to other students who performed at the 80th percentile? And in our model, we give more weight to growth than achievement. Next slide. Post-secondary preparation is an indicator that has a few sub-indicators in it, with the first being a graduation credential. So schools actually get credit whether the student graduates from high school with a diploma, or if they get a high school equivalency certificate, such as a GED. So we give them equal credit. And we also have an extended graduation rate in our state, and we also use the extended graduation rate in our traditional model. So we do reward schools for fifth, sixth, and seventh year graduates. We just add them back into the cohort to give them credit. And the graduation credential is weighted more heavily than any of the other sub-indicators under post-secondary readiness. Credit earning is just a way that we can progress, track the progress of students toward an on-time graduation. So we track those credits in 9th, 10th, and 11th grade, and students or schools receive credit for the percentage of students that are on track to graduate on time. Next slide, please. So this is the last sub-indicator under post-secondary preparation. It's college and career readiness, and you'll see here there are three options. When you read from left to right, each option here gets more and more rigorous. That top line refers to a scholarship program that we have in our state called the Hathaway Scholarship Program. It has four different levels, and each level is tied to more money, which is, of course, tied to more rigorous curriculum requirements. And so if students were to complete the curriculum requirement at level one, that's quite as rigorous as the level of requirements at level two, and so on. So as you read from left to right across this entire chart, it is more rigorous from left to right. And so the way that this would factor into the model in terms of the score is a school would be rewarded for at the level of the highest observed outcome. So if you have a student that perhaps completed the Hathaway curriculum at a level one, but got an ACT at a level two, but did a CTE concentrator at a level one, the school score would be a level two for that student. We'd give them the highest score. Next slide, please. So this is for our climate indicator. Students take a 24-question survey where they talk to us about their perceptions about their experiences in their alternative school. And so we have taken those questions and we've come up with three overarching themes. What is their perception of staff support and respect, student support and respect, and high expectations? And so the first one is, to what extent do students perceive staff as supporting their learning and demonstrating respect for students as well as other staff? For student support, to what extent do students perceive other students as supporting learning and respecting each other? And high expectations, to what extent are students appropriately challenged with meaningful academic work? So that's what we're trying to get at with this survey. And then there's one open-ended question. And in order to receive a score at all, there needs to be a participation rate in each school of at least 85%. A school that falls below that can't receive a score because it's just not valid and reliable once you fall below 85%. And part of that is because we have really small enrollments in most of our alternative schools. Next slide. Engagement is our final indicator in our model, and engagement is addressed through what we call a student success plan. It's a form, a fillable form, and each student is assigned to a mentor in their school, an adult mentor, a counselor, a teacher, an administrator, whoever's assigned to them, and they go through this fillable form at least twice a year to talk about the student's goals and interests, including an attendance goal. That's a huge part of engagement. Academic history, attendance rate in history, and what their plans are after they leave high school and what types of activities they could engage in now to get ready for life after high school. And so this is something that is relatively new. last year did not require the alternative schools to do this because it was our first pilot year. This year, all of the alternative schools will be required to participate in this form. And so it'll be interesting to see how this kind of shakes out. And then what the schools do is they send to us, the department, a statement of assurance saying that they met these requirements, that they met with their students twice a year and went over the form. And then this is formally reviewed as an artifact during their accreditation visits, which happen once every 5 years. Next slide. And so for our implementation timeline, we are in our last pilot year. Schools do not receive a school performance rating. They just receive their data right now. This summer and the spring and summer, the technical advisory group will get the performance data from the last 2 years and set cut scores for each of those indicators that we talked about. And we will hopefully be fully implementing this in the next school year. It has been very favorably received by our state legislature. In fact, it passed the first read in education committee last week to finalize this, to allow us to make this fully operational in this last school year. So we're very fortunate. Next slide. And finally, I just wanted to touch on the difference between ESSA and alternative school accountability in our state. That bullet list there at the top, those are the indicators that are included in our high school list of indicators in our approved ESSA plan. And you can see there are a few things there that are not part of the alternative school accountability model. And we recognize that ESSA requires all of these things. And so what we will do is alternative schools will be identified for comprehensive or targeted support based on these indicators that you see here on the screen. However, for our state accountability, they'll receive a score based on the indicators we just talked about, with including climate and engagement, because we feel that the system that we have in place for alternative school accountabilities better meets the needs and priorities of the schools in our state. And so with that, I will take any questions. Thank you very much.
Great. Thank you so much, Julie. That was really, really helpful. And we do have a few questions coming in for you. The first is around climate. And so wondering if you have any recommendations of school climate surveys that alternative schools are using.
So in our state, we actually designed the survey for them. So each, all of the alternative schools in our state use the same survey. And we borrowed a little bit from surveys that were required under advanced ed accreditation. We used to use them for our state accreditation. And so we borrowed some ideas from them, but crafted the questions to better meet the what we were trying to get at with alternative schools. And so we just, we looked around, but we created our own. And I'd be happy to share that if anybody needed that or wanted that.
Okay, yeah, that would be great. And we're happy to throw that up on our website if you're able to share that with us after this webinar.
Sure, no
Another
problem.
Question we have for you is regarding how alternative education settings are defined in the state of Wyoming. So someone asked, in Wyoming, what specific student needs would define whether or not a student can be served in a traditional setting or an alternative setting? Can you speak to that?
Well, so the law doesn't really speak to that. We don't have a law that says, and so a student must exude these characteristics to be considered an alternative school. We're a local control state, and so a lot of those things are left up to the judgment of the individual districts. But, you know, some of it is, you know, not necessarily academic. Perhaps their emotional needs are better met in an alternative school because it's smaller, it's more intimate. And the kids tend to have, at least from what we see in our state, stronger connections with each other and their teachers in our alternative schools than we do our traditional schools. But we leave those decisions up to the district.
Great. Thank you very much. Another question we have is regarding CTE pathways. And so someone asked, any barriers or challenges to ensuring students in alt-ed schools have access to CTE pathways or career and technical education pathways that you had to work through?
Not really. That wasn't a concern that we heard. And again, our technical advisory group is made up primarily of principals and superintendents who actually work in these alternative schools. And these indicators were in part created by them. And so they have really good, strong, healthy partnerships, either with the traditional schools in their district or also with, we have 7 community colleges in our state. And a lot of the schools have really nice partnerships with them to complete those pathways. I think what they saw this was as was an opportunity for students to have another way to you know, score well on an indicator. And so no, I haven't heard any challenges in terms of, you know, do we have alternative schools that aren't able to provide this type of opportunity to students? That hasn't been a concern that I've heard about.
Okay, great. Well, thank you very much. And we will have some more time to answer more questions at the end of the webinar. And I am going to turn it over to Jesse Canham of AYPF to start us off.
Great. Well, hi, everyone. Today, I'll be presenting preliminary findings and an initial analysis from our recently conducted 50-state scan at AYPF. So this scan has been an evolving project over the past few years as AYPF has continued to build knowledge and relationships with state leaders. So before starting, I'd like to thank the AYPF staff and consultants that have contributed to this project, in particular, Danny Gillis, who is a former AYPF research and policy intern and a consultant whose hard work and research makes this presentation possible. So in an effort to better understand the education landscape across the country, AYPF conducted a scan of all 50 states in DC, investigating state approaches to alternative education before the implementation of the Every Student Succeeds Act, or ESSA. Given that accountability for alternative settings both precedes and transcends ESSA, this scan provides a baseline for where states are to date and provides insight into how approaches to defining alternative settings and holding them accountable may change in the coming years. The scan was primarily conducted through a review of state education agency websites and publicly available state legislation and regulation. It should be noted that information on state education agency websites may not always be updated to reflect the current state of affairs in any given state. As will be described more later, given that alternative education functions differently from state to state, oftentimes information regarding the processes and practices can be found in various places. Based on the information available, AYPF investigated three key areas, which Jen also discussed in her brief earlier in the webinar: definition, accountability system, and accountability measures. I will discuss each in the coming slides. And we present these national trends today in hopes of advancing the conversation about how alternative education and accountability for these settings functions across the country. While this conversation is extremely nuanced and there's a lot to digest, this presentation presents a brief outline of our initial findings, and a more detailed document with our findings is forthcoming in the next few months. Next slide. So we started by investigating if a state had a definition, and if so, how it was codified. As explained earlier in the webinar, definition and codification are important to ensure states capture the purpose, needs, and progress of education institutions that differ from traditional settings. As you can see, 46 states have defined alternative education or settings in some way. Of those 46, 33 do it through state legislation and 13 through other mechanisms like state regulation, listing it on a state education agency website, or within documents such as accountability manuals. Next slide. We also explored how alternative settings are held accountable. Federal, state, and public accountability mechanisms can be used to hold these settings accountable, and we looked at these collectively to explore how and if states hold these settings accountable to ensure quality and support continuous improvement. Through research, we found that accountability for these settings fits within two key categories. One, that accountability is the same for traditional and alternative settings, and two, that accountability systems include modifications for alternative settings. As we will see in the next slide, most states have modifications in accountability for alternative settings. These modifications vary greatly. In some states, the modification may be inclusion of a different measure or differences in weights associated with a given measure. In other states, these modifications include distinct, separate, or parallel systems or frameworks of which alternative settings are evaluated amongst each other. You can see that we found that 16 states have the same system for traditional and alternative settings, and that 25 states include modifications for alternative settings. I also want to note that in each table, you'll see an N size. This indicates how many states we could make a determination about. In the case of determining accountability structure within these two categories, there were some states that we felt we could not make a determination given the information that was available. As you can see in this table, we're reporting findings from 41 states. Next slide. As we've seen in the last two presentations, discussing what measures are used for alternative settings is an important part of the conversation. AYPF explored measures of academic performance, graduation rate, inclusion of participation or completion of other credentials such as a GED or technical certificates, and student engagement measures such as attendance, re-engagement, student voice, and school climate. I will focus on two of these measures, academic performance and graduation rate, in the coming slides. Next slide. Of the 37 states we could report on, we found that 34 included a measure of academic achievement. Statewide and standardized assessments were the most common way to measure achievement. We also investigated growth. Due to the fact that alternative settings are often designed to serve students who are already behind academic benchmarks, measures of growth allow for measurement of progress and can allow states to more meaningfully differentiate between high and low quality settings. We found that out of 34 states, 17 used growth as a measure. For 6 states, it was optional, and 11 did not use growth as a measure. Next slide. This table displays the number of states that are using 4-year and extended year graduation rates as measures within their accountability systems for alternative settings. Using extended year rates in addition to 4-year graduation rates allows states to acknowledge the 4-year graduation rate timeline while also recognizing that students have various trajectories to reach a secondary credential. Using extended year rates can acknowledge a school or program's work and progress to support a student to that credential. Next slide. And so on this slide are just a few key takeaways from the scan. Firstly, there's a wide variety in definition of alternative education across states. While most states define alternative education in some way, some definitions are vague and short, while others provide a more detailed outline of what alternative education looks like in the state, such as the population served or the instructional method used. Earlier in the webinar, Jen described the various ways in which states are approaching accountability under ESSA, and Julie described their plans in Wyoming to proceed with an alternative school accountability framework at the state level. The pre-ESSA scan demonstrates that some states have been using the same system for alternative and traditional schools, and that many have been instituting various levels of modifications. States are leveraging accountability mechanisms at various levels to develop innovative systems and measures that reflect quality and success in alternative settings. And a few words on ESSA. From our work in the space, we see that ESSA has been a motivating factor for some states to start considering these issues. And for others, it's been a lever and potential support for already existing work. In acknowledging that under ESSA, states must create systems that meaningfully differentiate all public schools, some states have used these provisions to share how they will use modified mechanisms to differentiate between low and high quality settings. We also see that ESSA provides the opportunity to use rigorous yet nimble measures and allow flexibility, for example, the weights assigned to each measure. The scan process also demonstrated that inclusion and accountability systems for alternative settings can often be affected by the size of the setting and the classification as a school or a program. Another interesting finding was the manifestation of local control in some states. While the state provided a framework, decisions about certain measures or the structure of programs in schools would be left to localities and districts to decide. The research has also made clear that many states acknowledge the importance of accountability and the complexities of alternative education and are in the process of reconsidering their current state of affairs. Some states indicated on their website or in memos that they were in the process of convening stakeholder groups and work groups to tackle these issues. The scan also demonstrated areas for further inquiry. One area for further inquiry would be the examination into the states where there was not enough information or clarity to make a determination about their accountability structure, as this lack of information could indicate an absence or lack of accountability for alternative settings. Another area for further inquiry was the fact that many alternative schools are charters that can also have their own mechanisms of accountability in addition to state, federal, and public accountability. This dynamic could be explored in future projects. One last area for deeper study, as mentioned above, are the factors that affect inclusion and federal and state accountability, such as the classification as a school or a program and the size. Next slide. And to close, I want to highlight a few new resources and next steps for AYPF. As mentioned, a written publication on the findings from the 50-state scan is forthcoming. Additionally, AYPF is currently conducting a scan of all ESSA state plans, reviewing the plans once approved for mention of alternative education and accountability for those settings. And finally, AYPF recently launched an alternative education resource page to serve as a hub for AYPF and partner resources related to this topic. The policy brief that Jen described can be found on this page, along with a few other featured resources displayed on this slide. Thank you.
Wonderful. Thank you so much, Jesse, for that great overview of our scan. We have about 15 minutes left and a lot of questions are coming in, and so I'll do my best to get through as many as we can. And I think we'll start with one for Julie. We have a couple questions coming in around what accountability might look like across different types of alternative schools. Can you speak to that at all, whether or not that changes and what that differentiation might look like across different schools?
So the differentiation comes from the scores on each indicator and sub-indicator. So it will become apparent to us as we go forth with the full implementation of the model, you know, where the alternative schools have strengths and where they need a little more assistance. And so that's one thing I really like about having a model with target levels that are set for each indicator, because it's easy for us to identify those strengths and those areas of struggle for these schools. And then we also have an Edmodo site that is set up just for alternative schools, so that then the schools who are really strong, say in the areas of an attainment credential or engagement or things of that nature, can share ideas with other schools who maybe struggle with getting their kids to come to school or getting them to engage in the work or things of that nature. So that's the way that we meaningfully differentiate from school to school, is at that indicator level.
Great, thank you so much. And sorry for that pause, folks. Another question we have for you, Julie, is we had a question around advice for youth, parents, and organizations working with at-risk youth in alternative settings and how they can be better advocates for the best interests of their students. And so I was wondering if maybe you had any insight from the task force that you mentioned and can speak to how any states or districts can facilitate community feedback and dialogue in the creation of alternative accountability systems.
Yes, so we're pretty fortunate because we are a small state, and so even the State Department of Education is kind of like one big school district, and so we're really lucky because it's really easy for us to communicate out with all of our districts and our communities because we are so small. But I would definitely encourage that whatever you do, that it is a stakeholder-driven process, that is not the state coming in and saying, we think we know what's best for alternative schools, and this is what it's going to look like. But that you get people who are on the front lines as part of that, that have a really significant role in the work, that it's not just us and technical experts telling them how it's going to be. In terms of getting support to even do this, our state legislature is very active in education in our state, which is sometimes a curse as well as a blessing. And so we're very fortunate that way as well. But I always encourage people on any issue to contact their local legislator, to take part in that democratic process and reach out to them and say, hey, here are some things that states are doing for alternative schools. Let's look at this. Could you support a bill? And it's always a great idea, I think, to encourage the legislature to write in a year or two of pilot time so that you can work out the kinks to make sure that it's all going to work. What the model looks like today, what I just showed you today, is slightly different than what we started out with, you know, a year and a half ago.
Great, thank you. And just as a quick follow-up, and then we'll move on to some other questions from our other presenters, someone's asking what the U.S. Department of Education's response has been to the alternative system accountability model in your state as a separate accountability system within Wyoming's plan. Can you speak to that?
Sure. So there hasn't been a response because we are following the federal law in terms of, you know, the ESSA plan is designed to identify schools for support, either comprehensive support or targeted support or additional targeted support. And we have to use the same indicators for all the high schools to do that. And we are doing that. We will do that even for the alternative schools. And so there is no departure from what the requirements are under ESSA from what we plan to do to identify schools for those levels of support. Outside of that, we can basically do whatever we want. In fact, our traditional high school model for our state is also slightly different than what we submitted under ESSA. And so it doesn't really, I wouldn't think, matter to US Ed because we are following the requirements that they've laid before us for ESSA to identify schools for that comprehensive and targeted support. But in terms of how do we rate schools and things like that, we are using the model that works best for Wyoming, and they haven't said anything.
Great, thank you so much. And this question is I'm gonna start with Jen, but I think Julie, I'd like you to chime in as well. So Jen, how can states address accountability when many alternative settings are often small and by design and can be exempt from federal or other forms of accountability due to their size? Can you get us started on that question?
Yeah, so you kind of cut out on me a little bit, but I got the gist of the question as being about the size of these schools and how that might, is it meant to be, is it might count them out of the accountability system?
Yes, that's correct.
Okay. I would say that is an issue that we have looked at because, like, as we know, ESSA is only requiring states to look at schools that have 100 or more students. And there is some concern that some schools may actually hold their programs down below that 100 student cut point so that they don't have to necessarily fall within the accountability system. But for the most part, I don't think that is going to be a massive issue, but it is something that we're concerned about. And then also something that, you know, we have looked at because an issue that the Grad Nation campaign has really, tried to push lately is special education, students with disabilities. And so we know that they have really low graduation rates. We also know that they tend to be overrepresented in alternative settings. And so there is some concern that there is going to continue to be a push out. And given the fact that certain states are setting their cutoffs of how many students in a given school in these different subgroups, is pretty low, pretty high, I should say, in terms of, you know, what they're going to look at. So there is some concern about that we may not be getting an accurate picture, but until we start seeing exactly, you know, how this plays out, I don't have a definite answer on how significant of an issue it might be.
Great, thank you. Julie, do you have anything to add to that?
Sure. So I'll just let you know that in Wyoming, our in size for all indicators is much lower probably than a lot of other states because we would end up excluding a lot of schools. So our in size is 10. There must be a minimum N of 10. I think most states went with 30. And so we did that intentionally to make sure that more schools were included and more subgroups were included, including our alternative schools. And so as long as schools meet the minimum N of 10 for at least two of the indicators, they will be identified and receive support. So we did take that into consideration when we were setting our small schools definition, and it does definitely apply to alternative schools because they do tend to be smaller.
Great, thank you. And another question that came in for you, Julie, is questioning whether the Wyoming pilot run was for all schools or only a subset of schools. Can you clarify that, please?
Sure. So the pilot was applicable to all alternative schools, with the exception of the engagement piece. That was optional for the alternative schools in the first year, and then it was required this year and will be required going on. And that's because we were introducing a new model. We didn't want to throw too much in them at once. So we did have some schools the first pilot year that decided to go ahead and participate in the engagement piece, but some did not. Now they all are. We also offered our survey out to all of the traditional high schools. In our first year, we didn't get very many traditional high schools that were that interested in participating in the survey, but we have a really great vendor that has created a really informative platform where the schools can not only see what the participation rate of their school is, but they can see how their students in the aggregate answered, what the perceptions of the students in their schools are, how they compare to other alternative schools, how they compare to other schools in the state, statewide. So this year, we had a lot more traditional high schools opt in to participate in this climate survey. I don't know that they'll continue to want to do that forevermore because it's not required under the traditional model at this point. But the alternative schools were required to participate in the survey all along, so year one and year two. And the rest of it is required because it's required that they participate in the state assessment, and that's where our achievement and growth comes from. And it's, you know, required that they report their graduation rates to us. So all of that has been going on, you know, for years.
Great, thank you so much. Another question that came in was around tracking post-graduation outcomes for students in alternative settings. And so I want to ask you first, Julie, and then Jen, if you have anything to add to that, if you have any guidance as to how to best track post-graduation outcomes for students in alternative settings.
So that's sometimes difficult to do, but because of our scholarship program, our statewide scholarship program, students that graduate and enroll in any of the community colleges or a university are pretty easily tracked because we look at, you know, the graduates and we compare them, you know, those who took the scholarship compared to those who didn't take the scholarship. So, you know, if they leave high school and enroll in college, that's a little bit easier to track, especially if they stay in state. If they leave high school and enroll in an out-of-state college, if they go into the workforce, if they do nothing, that's a little bit harder to track, but it is definitely something that our State Board of Education and our legislature have an interest in. So I imagine that's going to be a pretty huge topic of discussion for the technical advisory group this spring and summer.
Great, thank you. And Jen, let's actually broaden that question. I'm curious what advice you have for anyone listening in terms of what resources or other states people can look to for guidance on how to tackle alternative education in their state beyond tracking up these the post-secondary outcomes.
That question to me.
Oh, sorry. Yes, Jen, that was to you. So curious if you could share what other states and resources can people look to for guidance on how to tackle alternative education accountability in their states?
So I will first just point you to the brief. We actually have two tables in our brief that look at all of the given ESSA indicators and how states are handling those types of things, sometimes very differently. And like I said, while we use the ESSA indicators, not all states were, a lot of states were doing this well before ESSA and already trying to look at these things. And so some of these things have been very established. But I would look at page 14 and 15 of the brief in terms of, you know, what states are doing. In terms of post-secondary tracking, I would just reiterate what Julie said. It is a little bit challenging in order to track those things. I mean, a lot of times it's just youth report back, but I know some states are trying to do a better job of tracking. Indiana is a state that actually comes to mind, of a state that is doing more to see what's going on, and they're not doing it just for alternative settings, they're doing it for all schools, but really trying to look and see what happens when those students leave high school. And you know, we hope that more states try to do more around that without obviously interfering with, you know, data privacy and things like that are always a big issue. But the more that we can learn about are these especially alternative settings and especially ones that have a CTE bent or ones that are trying to connect students to post-secondary as a way of re-engaging them. And a lot of them do probably track these stats on their own. So, you know, if you're interested in certain programs, I would go to their websites. But yeah, that is something that I think would be really, really important, and hopefully we'll get more information as time, you know, moves forward.
Great, thank you so much. And I just want to be mindful of the time here. We're coming up on 3 o'clock Eastern, and so I'm afraid we have run out of time. I want to take a second to thank our presenters, Jen, Julie, and Jesse, for joining us today. Thank you so much. And for any questions we were unable to get to on this webinar, that their contact information is located there on the screen. So we encourage you to reach out to them with any lingering questions you may have. Please join us for the second webinar in this three-part series on March 27th. It is going to be at the same time from 2 to 3 p.m. Eastern, and the registration information is there on the screen. And finally, as a reminder to everyone tuning in, please feel free to take our survey upon exiting the webinar, and the recording of the webinar will be posted on AYPF's website within 48 hours. Thank you again for taking the time to join us today, and we hope to see you again real soon.